Diese Konferenz wird nun aufgezeichnet.
To Christian and I'm looking forward to your presentation.
So, thank you very much for the nice introduction. So, let's see if this works.
Looks good.
Okay. So, I think everybody should now see these slides. Is it correct?
Perfect. Yeah.
Okay, so the online talk is Metagenomic Adventures with Nanopore Sequencing. Jens Hellwanger already introduced myself, but just for a quick note, during my time abroad, basically four main key aspects are the ones I did my research on. So it was about nanopore sequencing, and I investigated metagenomic samples from biogas reactors. And to analyze those, I actually needed to develop bioinformatic pipelines and did some cloud computing. And this all those technologies are basically under the aspect that I wanted to investigate how antibiotic resistance maybe are still available on mobile genetic elements. So this was basically the research grant that I received and about. But before we actually start, the question arises, why nanopore sequencing? And the title of this presentation is Metagenomic Adventures. So let's first go on actual adventure in India. So during a hands-on workshop on nanopore sequencing in India, it's part of a so-called Nanolog project, and it is about sequencing at the Ganges River, various parts of the river, because I think everybody knows how polluted this is. And this project addresses some of this concern, and it was about sequencing metagenomes and also checking out how resistance genes transfer. So we arrived here in New Delhi, and we wanted to sequence, in this case, up in the north, the Ganges River, near the Himalaya region. So Google already told us that we need like 5 to 7 hours to get there, but apparently Indian traffic is a bit more difficult, so it took us a bit longer. And after passing a lot of cars, we finally reached our destination, Tapovan. And the interesting part here was for us, we took all our equipment that we need with us because we were miles away from any lab that we could use. And a bit more in the north of the city, we arrived at this riverbank, and this is where we took our samples. So I was actually there, as you can see, so I'm not making some things up. And we also did some nice pictures for the media. And after all this, the actual sequencing started. So that means this is something you can do actually with nanopore because it's quite portable. So we set up here a small DNA isolation part. We set up our laptop back there with the sequencer. And after we isolated the DNA, we directly sequenced it on this metagenome up in the north. So this is why nanopore sequencing opens up some interesting possibilities. We used for this a so-called rapid in-field sequencing kit. So you only have like three tubes that you need to actually prepare your DNA. So it's like half an hour, and then after you got your DNA, it's half an hour, the library is prepared, and then you can put it on the sequencer and actually do the sequencing. Interestingly enough, after the night, still the pores were still a bit active, so while driving back home, we were still able to sequence a bit. This just serves as an example of what you can actually now do with the nanopore sequencing device if you actually want to directly sequence somewhere and you're maybe afraid that your samples degrade or something, or that the storing condition might influence anything. So without getting too much details about this project, I put the links down here if you're interested about this project. More importantly, just as a general information, for instance, these are samples from a freshwater part, so a bit like clean water samples from the Ganges. And these are samples from the after the city Kanpur. For people who work with antibiotic resistance, they maybe noticed those names. Those are all resistant genes, and not just any resistant genes. These are actually the one causing lots of issues in the clinical settings because they confirm multi-drug resistant. But again, this project is ongoing, so there's lots of analysis still to be done. I just wanted to show you what the application possibilities are when you're doing nanopore sequencing. So we're now going to the actual presentation, the main parts. And this online talk serves a bit as a complete overview for what you need to do if you want to do metagenomic sequencing. So the first part is I will talk a bit about DNA isolation. Usually in many talks is not really addressed because it's usually kind of boring or not interesting because you don't have nice colorful result figures. But in this case, I just want to show you quickly what some important aspects are if you want to really do sequencing on your own for metagenomic samples. The next part is taxonomic reclassification. This is where I will show you some nice colorful result figures. And in this case, I want to show you how you can use this to track the abundance, in this case for biogas reactor, as this was part of my research grant. And the last part addresses metagenomic assembly and results. So basically from the wet lab down to the bioinformatic part and result interpretation. These are the things we will address here now. So the first part, metagenomic DNA isolation with nanopore sequencing. The first question, so we're all on the same page, is a bit why we want to do nanopore sequencing. What's the advantage of those long reads? Reads are the raw data that the sequencer gives us. Usually if you have like a bacterial genome, you have multiple regions, in this case in blue, that are similar. It could be like the same gene or just the same DNA aspect. And also have this here. So when you have raw data, those assembler building those genomes have the difficulty that they don't know where the gene actually belongs. So for instance, if it starts here and ends here or end on the other side, because they actually need a long DNA read, which covers the whole gene and the regions before and afterwards. And if this information is not present, you get something like this. So it basically tells it knows the gene is there, but it doesn't know where it connects. And this gets basically more complicated the more regions you have that are multiple times in the genome, and it gets complicated and complicated. And in the end, for instance, for Illumina sequencing, you get something like this. While when you do nanopore sequencing, this is how your actual genome looks like. So this is a bit why we want to use long reads, so we can actually get nice, clean, and complete genomes out of it. And so for everybody to understand what nanopore sequencing actually means, in just a very short overview, the main component for nanopore sequencing is the nanopore here. And the technology works in a way where the DNA moves through the nanopore, and a current, an ion current, is measured. And it is dependent on those bases here. And then the graph is basically stored. So that means the DNA goes through here, the current is measured, and out of this current that is measured, you can calculate which bases are actually the ones that move through the pore. And this is why you can sequence long DNA fragments in one go, because it sequences as long as your DNA is. Of course, you have a bit difficult that you have multiple bases in here, and that's why nanopore sequencing has a bit higher error rate. But currently we talk of 95 to 97% accuracy on the raw data. It's currently at a stage where it's more than enough to actually analyze single nucleotide point mutations with nanopore sequencing. So why does I explain this to you? Because it's super important to understand what you actually have there. And everybody knows this from the wet lab. If something can go wrong, everything usually goes wrong. So for instance, the first thing is bad quality. I mean, you know now you have like a nanopore, whatever is attached to your DNA will basically clog your pore. And that means you this pore is then basically inactive and you can't sequence with it. Similar is for strand breaks. They reduce the length of your DNA and somehow they can also get stuck. Lots of super small DNA keep your pore busy. And this also means you won't sequence long DNA, and short DNA will be first at those pores. And the other way around, if you don't have enough DNA, your pore is basically stale, doesn't do anything, and usually also deteriorates after time. So basically, these are the main four aspects that you're looking for. That means you want clean DNA, you want to repair the DNA, you want to remove super short DNA, so everything below 500 base pair or 100 base pair, and you want to make sure that you give enough DNA, but not too much to your sequencing run. So what did I had a sample for your biogas reactors? Usually it's something muddy or like this, so perfect, like the worst case to get DNA out of it in a good quality. And without getting too much details, just as a quick overview, agarose G is actually your best friend here. So for instance, if you look at the figure above, if you have like a normal culture in the lab, your band length look like this, so you won't have any smear in here. However, when you do metagenomic isolation, you usually lose, you use mechanical bead shearing. That means your DNA breaks, but you need to do it because a chemical lyser usually misses a lot of bacteria that are difficult to lyse. And then you get, of course, the smear due to the mechanical force. So that means all the steps that you're trying to optimize then, for instance, like additional wash steps, is to reduce the smear down here, like the super low DNA fragments. And you try to get everything basically up. So you want long DNA. That's what we basically did here. Or I applied several wash steps. I tried a pre-treatment. For instance, in biogas reactors, you have the difficult issue that it's like an active digestion. So you have lots of from dead cells and DNA remains like super small one. And just a simple removal of the supernatant and replacing with water also reduced in comparison the smear. And that's basically what you're aiming for when you have a metagenomic sample. You try to apply different steps to just get everything up. It's something around 20 gigabases of data, if you look at this figure. So every dot represents one sample. I think the theoretical maximum of one flow cell for nanopore sequencing is around 50 gigabases, and the community is somewhere around 15 to 20 gigabases. So even though you have like difficult to isolate DNA, you're still able to sequence quite a lot out of it. And usually you get something around 7 million reads. More importantly, also the read length of your DNA is affected if your sample is fresh or frozen. And with frozen, I mean the sample is frozen before DNA isolation. You don't want to freeze DNA because the ice crystals are shearing your DNA, and then you have the same issue. It's damaged and also it's shorter, and you want to avoid that. So basically, what this graph mean, this is basically the take-home message here, is when you have around 20 gigabases, it means around 10 gigabases have a length of over 5,000 base pair or even more. So I was able to reliably get quite a lot of long DNA out of it. And to finish this up, so if you're interested in those DNA isolation procedures, I have a protocol up here online, where all these steps and problems are described and how to optimize everything, so you can isolate DNA on your own. At the end of the presentation, I will give a link to a web page where all the resources I use here in the presentation are also there, so you don't need to worry if you can't write it down. So the second part is now the taxonomic reclassification of this presentation. So the problem, or let's put it the other way, the previous gold standard or what's usually done is meta-barcoding. So that means 16S RNA is isolated from any metagenomic sample. PCR is then used to amplify this. So we have lots of amplicons. And by comparing samples, one tries to identify how those abundance change. But the problem is, of course, you're doing a PCR amplification in this process. So that means everything is basically biased based on how well your PCR works, how good your primer been to certain organism. So this is basically like a relative abundance. You can't really say an organism is super plentiful there or not. What we're doing in metagenomics, we have our samples with the genome, and we basically sequence everything. And based on this pool on data, we taxonomically classify each read. So what I did then, that was the first issue I had. So I have sample one here in this case. And I noticed that the database, of course, is super heavily influencing my results. So what you see here is like the proportion of classified reads. And I started just with the NCBI database, and I couldn't really classify anything. So it's like 10% of my whole sample could be classified only with NCBI. So that's what the first idea that you already see, that the database impact is especially high for reclassification, more so than the actual tool that you're using. So perfect, already the first issues here. So what I want to show you here is the so-called genome taxonomy database. So whenever, especially for environmental samples, whenever you want to taxonomic classify your data, you should think actually, and it's bacteria or archaea, you actually should use this genomic taxonomy database. They have a way more coherent species definition, And those classifier tools are super dependent on that AD database is really correct. And the NCBI database has lots of errors still in there. And this is confusing basically how the classification algorithms work. So you really should ensure that you're actually using a good database that could describe your metagenome. And this one so far, I think, is currently the best approach to classify bacteria or archaea. So to put this now a bit into a summary, so what I did, I had like 20 samples and I tried out various databases shown below here. And this is the amount of reads I could classify. And I did this for long reads, so what I sequenced with Nanopore, and I also compared it to Illumina sequencing. And in this case, I used exactly the same DNA from the isolation. So both of those samples had the same DNA, and they were used one for Nanopore sequencing and one for Illumina sequencing. You see already that when you use NCBI RefSeq, most of the reads are super low classified, so lots of my reactors unknown. And the interesting part is if I use a GDDB dataset with over 50,000 genomes, so this one, or if I dereplicate the database, like those two, to half of it while still maintaining the same amount of species, the classification rate is still similar to the high one. And it's a bit important because taxonomic read classification is super compute intense because you need to put the whole database with all the genomes in there in the RAM of the in the RAM of the computer. So that means any database that can get smaller and more handleable while still maintaining a similar classification rate is kind of useful if you want to analyze this data. So, but the general take home message here is don't use RefSeq NCBI. You don't really get enough information out of it. Use other database. In this case, for me, the GDDB database was more than sufficient. So I want to show you now a few results from my biogas reactor. So first of the explanation how my results now look like. So what you get then basically is on the left side, the phylum description. In this case, based on the GDDB, that's why you can see that, for instance, Firmicutes has multiple subphyla, and this is one sample then. And in total, we have 100%, and in this case, those four ones represent 20% abundance. So if I now look at all my samples, so down here, I have 10 German samples and 10 Swedish samples. This is what you can then do when you're doing read classification. You can compare you can also do it for one reactor over certain time frames. When you change, for instance, a certain process parameter, then you can observe how it changes over time. So in this case, for the project I had, something that is, for instance, easily spottable, we had so-called thermophilic reactor. They run at higher temperatures, and that's why, of course, thermogota of the phyla are way more present in those reactors. Other interesting parts is, for instance, those two reactors. So as this is a normal wastewater reactor, and the first one, this is a so-called lab scale reactor, and the substrate that was used for this reactor is based on this one. However, this was run completely independently of the other reactors, so while they still maintain a kind of similar phyla, there are lots of difference already. So kind of interesting, even though the lab scale reactor is based on the second one. Another interesting aspect are those two reactors. This is from one facility in Germany, and there are two separate biogas reactors. Those two, however, they use the exact same substrate and process parameters. So it's interesting to see, even though they are completely separated, they still have basically nearly the same phyla shown. When I look down on species level, you see already quite a few differences there, but the main composition still is the same, even though they are not connected at all. I didn't show you any genus data level because, as you can see, it's getting more and more data. It's still analyzable, but for the presentation, it would be a bit too much. So what I also did, I compared directly again Illumina versus the Nanopore sequencing. As you can see, the overall picture, so in this case Illumina Nanopore in sample 1, is super similar. You have sometimes a few differences for Illumina or Nanopore where the abundance is a bit higher or lower, but the general classification rates are quite similar. So you don't really, so that means you can use nanopore quite reliable to classify those reads. On species level, there are some differences for a super low abundant organism, for instance, as you can see here. So that means sometimes one technology could classify some super low abundant species while the other could not, or the other way around. But either way, nanopore sequencing is more than applicable if you want to check your abundance in reactors, for instance. So, I mean, this was just a quick summary. So the data I have is published here in more detail, if you're interested. And I compared there also more in detail how Illumina differs from nanopore, so what the amount of agreement is and so on. And also the whole DNA isolation protocol is also available if you're interested. We're now going to the last part of this talk, that's the metagenomic assembly, and a bit how should I actually do it. So that we are all on the same page, basically. Similar to the read classification, we have our DNA isolation. We're doing shotgun sequencing. So we have short or end long reads. And instead of just classifying it directly, we're doing now the assembly. What you get is then lots of DNA contigs built out of those reads. And then you do a process called metagenomic binning. As you can already see from this figure, for instance, the red genome is quite low abundant in total. So you get only a few reads and maybe just one contig or none at all. So that means at the end, you really actually lose your genome or you don't have enough data to actually show it. And binning basically uses all the available data. For instance, it tries to classify taxonomically or tries to look for certain housekeeping gene or uses the amount of reads that correspond to this certain contig to identify which of those contigs actually belong together. And this is called meta-assembled genome. Or in this case, like a species bin. So that means we separate all the contigs into separate species bins. So how did we do it? I developed with my master's student in Sweden a complete metagenomic workflow pipeline, because actually it's a quite complex analysis step, because you have lots of different smaller tool steps to actually achieve those goals. So just exemplary, I just want to quickly go over so you have a better understanding what all these steps is that are necessary. But in the end, the whole thing is basically automatically. You just drop your raw data into it and all these processes will run automatically. But what you do, basically, you have your nanopore reads as an input. You have some quality control. And then you actually start with the hybrid assembly in this case for this pipeline. So you, we use long and short reads. And then you have the context, like I showed you before, and then the whole binning process starts. So in this case, we use multiple different binners, and we are doing something called differential binning. So that means we take reads from other samples and populate our context. So we map it against our context. And based on those different coverages and mapping data, these binners have additional information besides their own sample. And then when you refine this with MetaRep, you get way more high accurate bins instead if you just would do normal binning. We also add in so-called reassembly step. So that means a certain species bin, we get the reads for it and reassemble it again like a standalone process. So then after all the steps, then you have like all your species bins, and then you're doing this classification. So you're doing something like quality control, for instance, with CheckM, so to see if those bins are complete, if something is missing, if you maybe have some contaminations. And afterwards, you're doing taxonomic classification. In this case, we use again GDB via SAUMESH to just check out which species we actually have in each bin. We also added various annotation steps, in this case with ECNOC, and we have some CAC parsers there, so we can actually extract the functional pathways that are represented in each bin and also in total in the whole sample. And for the whole sample, it's kind of important. We also can apply RNA-seq data. So we see, this is especially important in biogas reactors, we can see which of the pathways are actually active. Because for a biogas reactor, you really want to make sure that the process is completely stable. And only, I think, 1/3 of the organisms are roughly known or well described in a biogas reactor. And that's why it's difficult to change some parameters, which could basically destroy the whole process. So it's difficult to maintain. That's why a metagenomic analysis is so important for it. So I mean, I talk now about this MAFIN pipeline, and this is now a bit more into the area of bioinformatics, but it's a super important topic, especially if you have lots of tools that you use for analysis. You really need to use a so-called workflow manager. So that means the MAFIN pipeline that I talked about is written in Nextflow, and it uses a virtualization for the programs like Docker and Conda. For the end user, it's quite simple. They have their ready-to-use workflow, and it's automatically downloading all the programs, so you don't need to worry about some installation hassle or something not working. While additionally, Nextflow gives us the ability that people can use compute cluster with certain workload manager, or even, for instance, Google or Amazon Cloud. All this is quite a time saver, and metagenomic analysis is also a super high compute intense, so you need lots of compute machines to actually analyze your data. And yeah, again, Docker and Conda is just to avoid all those installation nightmares where certain programs might conflict with each other. In case of Docker, this is for instance something that Google, Facebook, and Netflix are all using. It basically just means for this case that the program is pre-installed in its own separate container, and your workflow calls it down and just uses it. So you don't really have an actual installation. This is why I also want to just quickly touch cloud computing, because I think it's quite a game changer, especially for institutes who don't have real access to a high compute cluster, or they need maybe more advanced rights or admin rights to actually do good analysis. So this is also why we choose Nextflow here. So basically, all you need is your own computer. This could even be a simple tablet where you have your samples on. And basically, Nextflow automatically creates those computers depending on the samples and the properties that each process needs. And then inside the cloud, all the machines are started and run for the process. And the moment it's done, they close down the computer. So you need to think a bit about normally you have a ready-to-use cluster. But in the cloud, you really don't have any cluster. So your main computer is this one, and this is orchestrating all the computer starting and shutdown. And for cloud computing, you only basically pay for the compute node when it's up. So that is why you don't need then millions of euro to actually build up your own cluster. You can just use the cloud and can do those analysis quite cheaply. And for also parallel. So for instance, those metagenomic analysis take like 1.5 days per sample. And if I would run locally, I would actually need 1.5 days or usually 2 days per sample. So, but in this case, I can analyze all samples in 2 days together. And it looks a bit like this. So it's more like a NURB slide, but still. So you have the amount of cores up there in the cloud. And this is from 5 samples I analyzed, so 1.5 days. And you can see, for instance, during the assembly step, how all the cores are quite stale because they stick at those assembly. And after it's done, all the binning steps appear. And as you can see, the cores are adjusted here automatically. And at the end, I had some reassemblies for each bin, and I had lots of bins. And then you have lots of multiple small computers starting up here and analyzing my data. So to summarize this, first of all, we have a preprint ready for the pipeline if you want to use it. It's currently in revision. The pipeline is set up in a way that we can use it on Slurm, for instance, or for Google Cloud, it's directly tested there. And metagenomic analysis, so in this case, it's like super compute intense, and that's why you actually need a workflow if you want to work reproducible without any issues. In this case, you also don't need to worry about where you're computing because it just works in this case. So this brings me now to the metagenomic assembly results. So in the case of the 20 reactors, I actually had over 1,000 meta-assembled genomes. And this also means for the cloud computing, it actually started then over 1,000 separate computers, each with their own CPU and RAM, run after each other and in parallel. So all of these genomes have like over 70% completeness. So this looks a bit like this. When you have all those 1,000 genomes, each dot represents one genome. And this is the so-called completeness based on CheckM, so basically trying to determine if something is missing from the whole genome or if it's complete. You have here the genome size in base pairs, so like 4 million, 2 million. And based on the color, that's the contamination grade. So usually it's calculated if they identify in the genome genes that should usually belong to another species. But of course, it's a bit difficult if you have completely unknown genomes in there. It's difficult to estimate if it's now complete or if you have lots of contamination. So, but in this case, kind of interestingly, nearly half of all those genomes I have are at 90% to 100% completeness. So we could, with this muffin pipeline, get quite a lot of genomes out of there with really good completeness and super low amount of contaminations. In most cases, it's even 0%. And we have a lot that are completely closed here. So when you have now, of course, all those genomes, the first question arises, maybe do I have the same species in all those samples? And so you want to know how the redundancy is. So what you're basically doing is quite a simple process. I have all the 1,000 genomes here on the y-axis and all the 1,000 genomes here at the x-axis. And what you're doing basically, you compare one edge each other. That's why you have this blue line in the middle, because this is the part where you compare the same genome against each other. And that's, of course, blue one, and it means it's the same. So I only spotted a few smaller clusters here. So these belong to seven genomes. And they have, in some cases, one, but in most cases, only like 0.8, like 80% similarity, to put it simple. So that means the short message that I get out of this image is I have over 1,000 genomes, and the redundancy across all those genomes is actually rather low. That means we have lots of unique genomes in here to analyze. So we screened this taxonomically against the GGB database. Interestingly enough, we had only 71 that disagree. Disagree usually means for the classification, we identified two species in one genome. So it wasn't sure which of the species belonged to. So that were, of course, those genomes with the higher contamination probably. But we basically just ignore these and focus on those. So I have over 500 that are found and classified. So they are available at the database. And then again, we have over 500 with actually no match. And one should mention that in this GDDB database, there are the so-called meta-assembled genomes are also present in there. So there's quite a lot of genomes still left that are not described in any way. So as a quick overview, I mean, it's lots of data to go through, but I wanted just to quickly check how, for instance, I have 109 genomes here with Firmicutes A, nearly 100 Firmicutes G. And if I look now at the read classification from previous, these are usually the more abundant I have here. I actually can now see a bit, or like derived as a general idea, that is just doesn't mean there's like one genome super present. So we get lots of genome in those abundance. So it corresponds a bit to what we see in the read classification, which was kind of interesting. But for us, more importantly, were, of course, those no-match meta-assembled genomes. To give you an idea of what you then have based on those, I had over 150 bacteria, where bacteria was the classification we got. So we don't have any phylum, class, order, or family information. But for instance, for those genomes, you only had like Firmicutes, Bacteroidetes, and no more class, order, or family classification. That's a bit what you need to work. So then the next step is basically in trying to understand what you have there. And this is where those KEK pathways come into place. So basically trying to identify what the pathways are. And in case of bioreactors, we want to know in which pathways they are connected to, basically. Here, just as an example, also from the MUFFIN pipeline, we use RNA-seq data also. And in green, these are the expressed genes. So we have all the pathway, in this case, the methane metabolism. And based on RNA-seq data, we can actually highlight the pathway which is active. So you get a general idea if a certain pathway, for instance, this one is active in the reactor or not. And similar can be done for each of the unknown genomes, why we can't really use RNA-seq data, because RNA-seq data was derived out of the whole reactor, so we don't know to which species belong. We can still use the annotation to identify what the unknown organism are actually doing pathway-wise. So for instance, if genes are there that are present in the methane metabolism or not, so we can know if those unknown organisms contribute to the reactors or not. So to summarize this up, basically, When you have a really good working metagenomic pipeline, you are able to get lots of genomes out of there, and then usually, especially if it's environmental samples, most of it is not described very well. So you get lots of genomes which you can't classify, and then you need to start digging deep. But this is ongoing research now at the Swedish University, so we're currently looking at those unknown ones so we can describe them. So the next part from the metagenomic assembly is about antibiotic resistance, because I wanted to investigate if antibiotic resistance is contributing, so if the biogas reactor is basically digesting those genes and then they are gone, or if they still persist. The question is always why antibiotic resistance is so interesting or important, and I just want to summarize this in this figure quite quickly. So for instance, you see Europe here, and these are data based on infections, and this is the rate of resistance by color. So this was in 2003, and in 2014, basically everything's orange. If I now look at the data 2020, I think now whole Europe is basically red, so that means we have lots of multiple drug resistance. Based on data, it means we have like 400,000 infections annually per year in Europe only. And based on those infections, we have 25,000 deaths. And just based on antibiotic resistance. So that means those patients died because they have multi-drug resistance and it couldn't be treated. And this data is from 2009. I mean, you see now here between 2003 and 14, 2020, it still gets even worse. And the data is somewhere around here on a time frame. So it's probably now way more deaths per year just because an antibiotic resistance is present. And that's why important to investigate what resistance persists, or if certain mechanisms like the biogas reactor, if they're actually contributing to it, or if they, for instance, digest all the waste. So one could do it, for instance, similar to Keck pathways. So I also investigated and tried and checked which of those for instance, penicillin binding proteins are there. It's something typical in MRSA, or if efflux pumps are present. And what I actually did then at the end was I investigated in detail from all the meta-assembled genome data that I have, which resistance against what of the clinical used antibiotics are present. And especially interesting if those resistance is located on a genome or a plasmid. So in this case, I used all the assembled contigs and classified them into a genome or plasmid, and then I started annotating and search for all the resistance genes. So without getting too much details here, it's still ongoing research. As you can see, lots of those resistance genes are still located on plasmids. And more importantly, this is down here, these are so-called beta-lactamases. They confer resistance against beta-lactam antibiotics. That's something everybody knows of. For instance, penicillin is a beta-lactam antibiotic. And they are basically the most potent treatment options against bacterial infections. And as you can see here, we have lots of genome located beta-lactamases, but still quite a lot of those are on plasmids. So, and especially worrisome is that it seems like most of these are not yet known, but these core, both class B and class B, that is nearly present in all of the reactors, are beta-lactamases that are able to cleave all beta-lactam antibiotics. So that means if an organism has this resistance mechanism, you can't treat it with beta-lactam antibiotics. And this usually means for the clinician, there are not much option left to treat the infection. So it's kind of worrisome that you still have so many of those antibiotics in the reactor. And this is the samples were collected during digestion. So if it would be removed, we would see it in those samples that we won't have much resistance, but it seems like we still have quite a lot there. Also, we looked. I looked for plasmids because they usually transfer all those antibiotic resistance. And for instance, in sample 3 from the German reactor, I found a lot of those replicons, and these replicons are and DNA in front of it and after it. So I had a lot of longer contigs. And this confers to the Staphylococcus aureus multi-resistant plasmid that you usually find in the clinical isolates. So while we didn't find really much Staphylococcus aureus in those reactors, we still found those plasmids there. So this is one of the questions we're currently investigating, if the plasmids, for instance, are collected by other organisms and therefore still persisting, And it seems like that the plasmids are still present and not digested during the whole process. It looks a bit like this, but this is of course lots of data. This is just from one reactor. So you see all the DNA contacts from plasmids. These are all plasmids. And annotated here in green is the beta-lactamases. And in blue, you see the plasmid replicons. And in red, other resistance genes. But this year, everybody knows that Corona hit us. So I was, most of this year, I did Corona sequencing for the hospital. So this is why I sadly couldn't continue that much on this project. And this is why I still wanted to show you what the current data status is. So for the future plans that we're currently addressing is we have lots of unclassified meta-assembled genomes, those bins, and we want to know what those are and how they're contributing to the biogas reactors. We have now all the data on KEK pathways, and we're doing some differential comparison between those reactors and these pathways and to see how certain parameters are influencing the biogas reactors. And I'm currently still doing the antibiotic screening and search for mobile genetic elements to see how it contributes. And with the nanopore data, currently I am employing methylation pattern detection so that I can identify for those plasmids to which species they actually belong. Because in a normal metagenomic sample, you don't really know where the plasmid belongs. But with pattern matching, this is a possible option. And this would really help to understand then where those plasmids actually belong to and if they might get some into some organism and persist there as some kind of a reservoir. So that was all from my part. Thank you very much for your attention. All the resources, workflows, publication can be found here at the Case Group webpage. And if you have questions, then I think I can now answer them for you. Thank you very much.
Yes, thanks a lot, Christian. Yeah, you can either switch on your microphone now if you have a question, or then you can also type in questions into the chat. So maybe we can wait a few seconds, but I can start asking a question. So when you were in the field taking samples, you already said that there is this field kit that the DNA preparation is less complicated, but has there been any other problems, like due to humidity or temperature, or is it just an ideal instrument, the nanopore, for field analysis?
I think for in-field sequencing, we don't really have much other option except just using nanopore. The more problematic part is currently getting the DNA isolation done outside of a lab environment. So what we did there, for instance, we used mechanical shearing, but based on vortexing, because we couldn't bring this whole huge machine with us to actually do this so-called bead beating. So that is why we tried this with vortexing, but it had a bit of the issue that we only get really small amount of DNA, so not much out of it. But I think there's no real other current option to actually do sequencing reliable in field. So yeah, hope this helped as an answer.
Okay, so the first question then from the audience is, how do you screen for the antibiotic resistance genes?
Currently, there are, I think, now 5 or 6 different collections to screen for antibiotics. Something like RestFinder, NCBI also has its own database, CART database, and a few others I can't recall. And I have 2 options that I'm usually employing. I use the long reads for nanopore sequencing. I utilize those and directly screen on them because we have here the advantage that the read is quite long. So you get additional information and know a bit where the gene is actually located. So you can identify upstream, for instance, plasmid genes. Otherwise, a quite handy tool is Abricate to utilize all the databases for screening. That is basically it, yeah. So either I'm using reads currently directly, or I use the pre-assembled context to screen for resistance genes. Hope this answer helps.
Okay. Then we have Jörg Linde, who said that he has 3 rather short questions. I think he probably, he's typing in the questions. Okay, so the first question is, how do you run ONT without internet?
There is actually an offline method available, but we had the luck there. We had, I think, 4 phones with us with mobile internet. And we did need to change a bit because of data volume, but we basically connected it to our mobile phone because it doesn't need that much internet actually to run.
Okay. Second is, any idea how to remove host, mainly animal DNA from metagenomics?
Yeah, there is currently something I, how to put it? I mean, of course, we can do this afterwards. There are lots of methods where you can map it against, but more interestingly now is the so-called read until API from Nanopore. This basically means you can supply the, during the sequencing run, the sequencer with, for instance, let's say your host is human and you want to remove it, you can supply it with a human genome. And during sequencing, I think like 300 base pairs get detected in the pore. Then it tries to determine if it's human or not. And if it would be human, it would be get tossed out. So you can basically do depletion and also enrichment directly during the sequencing so that you can increase your total yield to your targets, for instance, or reduce, for instance, like human contaminations. But this is, I think, quite a new technology. I think it's now on the beta branch, but it should be available this year.
Okay, and the third question is, can you give a rough estimate for a per sample price for ONT?
A rough estimate. So for if you want to use one flow cell, what I did, because I wasn't sure how deep I need to sequence to get enough answers, then you will have like 450 euros for the flow cell. And additionally, I think like 200 for the kits and DNA isolation, everything else what you need for the wet lab. So this is roughly what you need. Of course, if you don't look for, if you know what your sequencing depth is or which is needed, then you can get way lower and do barcoding. And then your price is basically split by the amount of samples. So if you can employ 3 metagenomic samples on one flow cell, of course, it's third the price per sample. So it depends a bit how deep you need to go. So what I did, it was actually quite deep nanopore sequencing. You can go way deeper and do more. But it depends on your question, on the organism you're looking for. So for instance, if I think if you want to do monitoring for your biogas reactors, you don't need to do as this deep sequencing like I do, because you look for the most abundant and active bacteria in there. So I think you could easily barcode like 4 or 5 samples to get the answer and the surveillance that you need to follow the process. Then it would be like, I don't know, 150 per sample, I think. 150 euro, yeah.
Okay, thanks. There's another question. Is it planned to merge the data from the other platforms into NCBI RefSex?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I saw that NCBI now, similar to the 16S database, they started now to adapting this taxonomic classification in there. But apparently in RefSec, there is no meta-assembled genomes present because they have some rules what they want to put in there. So it needs to be like culturable so that you can get a complete genome out there. So I think there is no real other database possibility. What I forgot to mention, you can use in GDDB, they link their taxonomic classification to the NCBI ones. So that means you don't need to worry if your classification can't be used, for instance, for publishing. You can always refer to the one that NCBI was giving. And they have a really nice paper published in Nature, the guys from GDDB, explaining a bit what they're doing. So it is actually quite a good database. But yeah, NCBI, I think, is correcting now also a bit based on this data. So it's not something really standalone. It helps for the other databases. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Then we have a comment. I think this is from Curatis Opgen. They say, we have developed for our diagnostic tool a lysator and a process for universal lysis, which might be interesting to be used for this kind of work. Get back to me if you're interested. And then we have another question. How did you handle nanopore error rates in taxonomic classification and antibiotic screening? Lots of these methods are based on open reading frames, but even with 3 to 5% indels, you won't get ore fragments from raw reads? Question mark.
So yeah, for the I need to check the comment again. For the whole classification, the main thing you can really only do because of the errors is basically blast approaches, so that you don't need to worry about that an indel causes a frame shift. The annotation is for the taxonomic classification. You have way than enough sequence information on the long read that makes basically up for the errors. I think there was a publication showing at around 2,500 base pairs is something like the breakpoint where the error rate doesn't matter anymore, in contrast, for instance, to an Illumina sequence read of 150 base pairs. So since I had like over three, the median was, I think, 3,000 base pair and 50 at 5 to 6,000, I had way longer than what was usually the breakpoint. And I think most of the taxonomic classifier are k-mer based. And in case for my read classification, I choose a bit smaller k-mers for the nanopore reads. So to address those indels so that I have shorter fragments, but as a restriction, I only accepted classification with a certain minimum length and enough k-mers that matched onto the read. Yeah, and for screening, I do this basically blast-based to identify the antibiotic resistant genes. For the assembly, then you don't, if you're doing culture-based for the assembly, you don't need to worry about those. I think we have now 99.7, or with the correct base color, 99.97% accuracy. I hope I could answer your question.
Okay, then we have a hand up from Alexander Probst. He probably wants to ask directly if you unmute your microphone.
Yeah, I already started typing this entire question in here, but I can definitely do that in person too. So thanks for this great talk. I really enjoyed it. It's the first time for me attending the seminar. I have a question regarding your 71 unknown or unclassified bins. How can you be sure that these are actual real bins? We see it very frequently that automated binning generates hybrid bins consisting of sequences from two or more organisms. Is this particularly, and we see that this is particularly prominent when having eukaryotes in the system, which is something that bioreactors can have too. And we usually do manual curation of each single bin, which is very tedious for 1,000 bins, of course, to improve the bins in general, and also to catch those hybrid bins that are actually non-existent in nature and shouldn't go into public databases. So how do you estimate the prevalence of this issue in your pipeline?
That's a very good question. I need to answer another question to you. Did you try differential binning? Did you use this so far? Because I need to adjust the answer.
Yeah, absolutely. We use multiple binners, and with that we then use Dust Tool. I co-developed Dust Tool. I don't know if you know that. The software Dust Tool, yeah. So that's what we use, and then we still need to do manual curation, because even Dust Tool puts out bins that are absolutely garbage, to be honest. That's just very few, but the problem is if those bins make it into public databases, you have error propagation, and then you create lineages on the tree of life that are actually non-existent.
Yeah, true, that's an actual problem. I completely agree. For the reactors, first, I just, like everybody's probably doing, I did some pilot experiments just with quick binning and check out what my data was. It was actually quite crap. I had here the bitty advantage. I have 20 metagenomic samples. So I had 20 times two read sets with closely related to this reactor. So what we could basically do, I've two of the binners, I forgot the name, which of those, they allow for additional bump files, basically like mapping files. So we could supply all those reads as differential bins. And then per sample, we had like 20, 30 or 40 bumps files for the binner. So we had way more abundance and those mapping information. And afterwards, that's why we got quite a huge amount of bins, which looked, at least from the pre-screening we did so far, really good. But of course, you need to do manual curation afterwards. But the differential binning helped quite a lot with those additional reactor samples that we just used.
Okay, thank you. May I ask another question? Have you considered using something like ukrep or something like that to detect eukaryotes in your system? Maybe I just didn't catch that in your pipeline.
As of far,
filter we did those out because that can also improve the binning.
Yeah, we did not yet do that. I know that similar to CheckM, there is now a tool in preparation at, I think, at the EBI that they use to classify eukaryotes. So similar to address which bin is actually from eukaryotes, because this CheckM is only used for bacteria, actually. So there's something we investigate. So far in biogas reactors, there can be, I think, a few fungal things in there, but usually it's mainly bacteria. So it shouldn't have that much of an impact, but something we will investigate either way. But didn't have the time yet to analyze it. But it could be a good strategy also to remove those reads first that may be classified to eukaryotics.
Yeah, or also using ukrep that uses machine learning to identify assembled eukaryotes and then pull those out to prior to binning. Ukrep is, yeah, Genome Biology Banfield Lab. Yeah, cool. Correct. Thank you. Really enjoyed your talk.
Thank you. Writing eukaryotic CC is the one for estimating the quality of eukaryotic meta-assembled genomes.
Yes, you can look up in the chat function if you want to see this link. Okay, so thanks a lot, Christian, for giving us this interesting talk. Christian is just setting up his own research group at the Institute for Infectious Diseases and Infection Control at Jena University Hospital. And we will also put a link to his work and his working group into this or together with a video of this presentation. Yeah, thanks also for answering all those questions. And we are very happy that you have been with us. And thanks everybody for participating. If there's no further questions, I think we will close the session now.
Otherwise, if you have